So it's wonderful to have Jeff here. He's been a great leader of the World Happiness Report, but of course he's worked on almost everything, and I've interacted with Jeff in many ways over the years. Just thinking of the list: unemployment, hyperinflation, post-communist Russia, economic development, and I'm sure I've left out very many others. But what I must say slightly surprised me was when I got a letter from Jeff in 2010 telling me that he got interested in well-being and he wanted to have a conference on this in Bhutan with the Prime Minister of Bhutan. So John and I went there, and it was a wonderful experience with the remarkable results, because Jeff told us we had to produce the World Happiness Report. And it had to come out in March 2012, which was when the UN had resolved to have a World Happiness Day and also to encourage governments to pay more attention to the happiness of their people. And so Jeff has actually forced us to produce a World Happiness Report almost every year since 2012, and we are now on to a proper regular basis. John has been fantastic in his analysis of the country data, which of course is why, because we have every country in it, the World Happiness Report has 1 million downloads a year. But this is just a tiny illustration of Jeff's fertile imagination. So Jeff, tell us about economics for the common good. And Jeff assures me there are no numbers.
Thank you very much. It's really a pleasure to be here and to celebrate the new book, which I haven't seen yet, but I'm excited to see. And I was also very happy and relieved to hear that it's filled with numbers, because I don't have a single number in my talk, except I think I have a list, 1, 2, 3 at one point. Other than that, I want to speak philosophically about the issue of well-being and how we are considering it. I think that what Richard and John Helliwell and others here and others in this field are doing is revolutionary and extremely important, and it will remake economics among other fields, because economics went wildly off track on this issue about 150 years ago, and a little more than that, I guess 200 years ago. No, a little more than that, actually. I'm going to start complaining back with Hume and even some of his predecessors. But I think economics went off track by a profoundly flawed model of human nature, and therefore a flawed model of human purpose, and therefore a field that doesn't know where it's heading, because it doesn't have much of a clear trajectory of what the good is. And without a better teleology, it's very hard to have a meaningful field. So it'd be like being in a field of public health, but you don't know what health is at all. If you have a field of economics, but you don't know what the good is the use of resources, you're bound to get a lot wrong. And for me, this weighs especially heavily in today's world, because we're so rich in our total production and in our capacities to do things that we could solve absolutely fundamental challenges, such as ending extreme poverty or addressing climate change for climate safety or preserving biodiversity without much effort. But our problem is that we don't even know what we want to do as a society. Our profession, my profession, is pretty useless on this, actually. Just horrendously misguided in what it spends its time on, because it spends its time on completely unimportant things. and neglects the very important things. So it's a matter of values and misdirection. And it cannot be the most important issue in the world whether the U.S. grows at another 3% or 3.5% or 2.5% per year, when over the last 65 years there's been no discernible rise in well-being by these measures, and lots of discernible worsening of social well-being in many other ways, and yet we can't even figure out to address that. But even more dramatically, we're about to destroy the planet environmentally, and we can't even figure out that that's important. We have these absurd debates about which discount rate to use and whether we should save the planet or not, because if the discount rate's at 0.04, we shouldn't save the planet, but if the discount rate's at 0.02, we should save the planet. Honest to God, you can't make this stuff up. So we have a very serious train incapacity. And this topic of well-being is essentially a topic of the question of what's important. And I think the field is reinventing a field of moral sciences, because moral sciences is, in my view, the scientific study of what's good for human beings. And we know a lot more about that scientifically than we did before, which is great, including from subjective well-being and many other ways, neurosciences and many other modern disciplines. But we also know a lot that we forgot. It happens that yesterday I was with the Dalai Lama in New Delhi for an event, and he would not be surprised to know that emotional health came out as the number one variable. It's just that we actually forgot that point somewhere along the line of the advertising boom of the late 19th century and went off in a crazy direction. So I'm going to speak philosophically about these issues. That's a detail from my favorite painting in the world, The School of Athens. And of course, you'll recognize Plato on the left, and my favorite philosopher, Aristotle, on the right. And Aristotle has in his hand the Nicomachean Ethics, which I think is the finest book in Western ethics ever written. And it's 2,365 years ago, roughly. So it's got a long pedigree. If you haven't read it recently, please do so, because it's really an absolutely astounding essay about well-being. He did no data in it, by the way, but really absolutely remarkable insights. And of course, the greatest good for Aristotle was eudaimonia, the summum bonum, and life was to be achieved by aiming towards this greatest good. And Aristotle's answer was about the formation of character, which we haven't talked about directly this morning, but we have it something about how the biggest decrements to well-being are poor emotional stability, it's measured in the data, or mental health, anxiety disorders, and so forth. Something about inner life and about an individual's orientation to own purpose as well as to social relations. And you could think some of that is organic disease, but a lot of it is epigenetic, and a lot of it is about interior life and interior purposes. And for Aristotle, the good life comes from building virtue. So virtue for Aristotle meant building excellence. And since Aristotle started with the direct notion that man is a social animal, excellence is partly the excellence of social relations. And in Nicomachean Ethics, there's a long section on friendship, for example, and different categories of friendship, but friendship for Aristotle is fundamental in importance of virtue. It's a virtue, friendship. It's not just a condition. It's a virtue, and you have to develop the virtue of being able to be a good friend, and there are different levels of that virtue. Well, we now call it social support networks and so forth, but it's the same idea that well-being depends on your relations with others. So here's my own guess about a neo-Aristotelian idea of the aim towards well-being. Of course, if you're a philosopher, you spend loads of time defining what eudaimonia really means and what the right translation is. Is it happiness? Is it well-being? Is it flourishing? Flourishing seems to be the preferred translation at the moment, but it means a full life, a good life. And so the idea of happiness is to develop a good life. It's not necessarily to take the score of subjective well-being, although that's probably an indicator. It's better to take the score of subjective well-being of an individual that actively pursues a good life and thinks contemplatively about it and is in a healthful social circumstance, ideally is an Aristotelian philosopher and has thought very deeply and heavily about it. But it seems that there are at least three prior determinants of a good life, and I would say that those are the individual's virtues, and individual's virtues mean the individual's interior mental health, stability, pursuit of excellences, meaning both the talents of piano playing or painting or being a scholar, as well as excellences of relations with others, abilities to form friendships or long-term partnerships. A second determinant is social context, and that means the kind of polis that you live in. This was for Aristotle the beginning. In fact, Aristotle famously says in the Politics that the polis comes first, the community comes first. The politics comes first, then the individual is only afterward. He said, how can you talk about hands and feet if you don't talk about the whole body first? So the basic point in the opposite of the social contract approach is that you have your political state, and your political state has its qualities. Trust, I would say, is the shorthand of the qualities of a well-functioning state. And the third is material conditions. And Aristotle is very clear also and correctly, and that's why I was a little concerned that income was being pushed right off the page, that material conditions matter. But in good Aristotelian mode, Aristotle said, moderation in all things. Don't take it to extremes. Believed that healthy material conditions were important, but were only one of these factors. So my view is that we should be trying to explain human flourishing by the individual's own orientation to life, by social trust, and by material conditions. Not surprisingly, my last slide, but I'll jump ahead. These are exactly John Helliwell's categories in the World Happiness Report. He has six categories, but they come down to issues of prosperity, income, and health, issues of trust, both generalized trust among individuals and trust of government, which are both categories of social trust, and virtues, of which, for example, a measure of generosity plays a role. Now, we have not analyzed well these determinants, so I can't put numbers on this path diagram for you about their relative contributions, but I think they're all fundamental. And what I think is crucial is that all of them need cultivation. So none of these exist by themselves. The virtuous life is a hard-won life. It's not something that just happens, and it doesn't mean you reach the O levels or the A levels. It's something that you strive for. And Aristotle devotes a lot of the Nicomachean Ethics and the Politics to the idea of what circumstances enable individuals to strive for virtue, and indeed assigns the central role of politics to help individuals to achieve their virtues. We don't even think in those terms anymore. Of course, with our leaders, it's an unimaginable concept. We just are happy when our leaders stay out of jail. But in Aristotelian thought, the idea is that the leaders instill, of course, you had Pericles, you instill an ethos of virtue in the community. You have to cultivate trust in the community. Social trust is not just a state. It is something that is subject to volition through social tools. For example, if you have a criminal enterprise like Wall Street, which is a criminal enterprise, and you don't put senior executives in jail when they commit crimes, and then you have a candidate, president-elect, who fills the cabinet with the very firms that he railed against a few weeks ago, and now we have a cabinet that has just, cabinet designate, that has is filled with the billionaires from the very firms that committed the massive fraud, that's not conducive to the cultivation of social trust. And that's a verifiable point because you can look at a Gallup survey and see that people don't trust their institutions. They don't trust government. They don't trust large enterprises. They don't trust the banking sector. And of course, they're completely correct. And of course, the field of economic development is about cultivating material well-being. So there's a lot known about how to promote economic development and what its antecedents are and what to do. But there's very little in our field of economics about cultivating individual virtues. In fact, the concepts barely exist. We have capital, human capital investment, but it's a pretty dry version of this notion. And in fact, I'll say in a moment, I think our field is weird in its understanding of these issues. So what about cultivating virtue? Aristotle said, I'm quoting, excellence is an art won by training and habituation. We do not act rightly because we have virtue or excellence, but we rather have those because we have acted rightly. We are what we repeatedly do. Excellence, then, is not an act but a habit. So in Nicomachean Ethics, you become virtuous by mentorship, by training, by practice, and eventually by habit, so that you're not straining to be good, but to be good is your virtue. That's just who you become. And to be good is not to say, God, I could cheat the other guy, but I'm not going to, and I understand it would be the wrong thing to do. It's not a Kantian deontological proposition. It's more, I'm habituated to be good, and therefore I'm a good citizen. I am a good commercial partner. I am a good friend. And so it doesn't actually come into my head now as a matter of habit. And how I've been raised, how I've been taught to cheat, or even the burden of resisting cheating in a prisoner's dilemma temptation or a public goods game. I'm good, so I want to be good and virtuous as a member of my community. And then, as I mentioned in the Nicomachean Ethics, he also says the end, or telos, of politics is the best of ends. And the main concern of politics is to engender a certain character in the citizens and to make them good and disposed to perform noble actions. That's a completely different world from ours, that the idea of politics is not the interplay of vested interests, it's not the struggle of power, it's not Weberian legitimacy of force, but rather it is the cultivation of virtue. It's really, to my mind, an important idea, completely lost from modern society. And for Buddha, of course, and the Dalai Lama, as he expressed it, he, by the way, had a wonderful speech yesterday about war, and his point was, do not pray for the end of war. God has nothing to do with it. It's human-made. So solve your problems without bothering God about all of this. Moreover, his point was you can't solve your problems of war without inner peace. And so, of course, with Buddhism, the idea is that it's inner peace which is key. And I think that it's just powerful in Richard's and colleagues' evidence. Inner peace, it's lurking there. It's called emotional well-being and so forth, but it's the single most important variable. It's got a slightly different name, and it doesn't have causation to it. It's as if it just is there. Mental health, anxiety disorder, depression, unstable childhood, but those are conditions that, according to Buddhism, are precisely what our focus should be on. It precisely should be to focus an inner peace, to focus a calm understanding vis-a-vis the world. And in Buddhism, as this is a quote from the Buddha's teachings, we are shaped by our thoughts. We become what we think. When the mind is pure, joy follows like a shadow that never leaves. And there are many modern variants of this that I think are important. Viktor Frankl, the concentration camp survivor, who wrote an extraordinarily important book called Man's Search for Meaning, with the compelling notion that life is never made unbearable by circumstances, but only by a lack of meaning and purpose. And so the question of what is the meaning? But we don't necessarily instill meaning in any useful way in our societies right now. In fact, there's a lot of evidence that there's a disarray, a lack of meaning or purpose of a lot of young people who are lost in society. And from modern neuroscience of Mesernick and countless others, the idea of brain plasticity, which is essentially Buddhism written into the neurons, which is that, as Mesernick says in this quote, your brain, every brain, is a work in progress. It is plastic. From the day we're born to the day we die, it continuously revises and remodels, improving or slowly declining as a function of how we use it. So that's almost literally a Buddhist idea, that we are what we think, and we can exercise our brain through direct brain exercise, through meditation, or through acts of compassion. But it obviously links with the Aristotelian ideas of habituation to virtues as well. Well, virtues fail, and people suffer as a result of that as well. And there are many reasons for failure. One is failures of nurturing. We know the incredible vulnerability of the young brain and to the vulnerability to stress and to changes in the cortisol systems, failures of education, massive failures of the mind, addictions, mental illnesses, autism spectrum, anxiety disorders, failures of cognition. We know that we're not very good at affective forecasting, of even predicting what will be good for us. But that's the whole purpose of most religions, or one of the purposes, is to say, by the way, what you think is going to make you happy isn't going to make you happy. That's an idea unknown in economics. It's literally unknown in mainstream classical economics 101. It's not unknown in so-called behavioral economics, which is discovering the obvious of other fields. Calling it a new discipline, but basically a way not to have to apologize for the last 250 years. But there are massive failures of cognition, and there are massive failures of politics, because if the idea of politics is necessary to shape virtue, we're obviously not doing a good job right now. In fact, we're doing the opposite. Our politics are teaching bad behavior and ruthlessness, especially in the United States. The politics are teaching you get what you can, you take it where you can, you probably won't have to pay any consequences. If necessary, buy an automatic rifle. This is what our politics are teaching right now. There's not a moment of discussion about virtues and values in the Aristotelian way. We also have an economy that actively promotes addictions. And so this is really something that we have a hard time grappling with, but whether it's tobacco or our sugar addiction, which led to the largest slave empires in history, or gambling addictions, or fast food addictions, or other addictions. We have a nonstop economic promotion of these, and it's the role of advertising in human unhappiness is profound, but tremendously underanalyzed. And in my view, tremendously dangerous. Some countries have seen fit to stop direct advertising to children. Some wise countries have seen fit to keep advertising limited to a few minutes at the end of an hour of television. In America, it's advertising morning till night, and we get what we bargain for, which is a constant hot button pushing on the brain, and this is absolutely deleterious to well-being. So I think the whole idea of cultivating virtue is about cultivating a life course. It's almost the definition. In this idea of cultivation, utility or well-being is not the sum of a flow of states or a flow of consumption, which is a really weird idea, by the way, that, you know, lifetime utility is the integral of e to the minus delta t u of c dt. How could anyone have such a theory of life, that it's basically summing up the flow consumption over time, as opposed to building some kind of meaning of life, which is a very different thing, and where your state now depends on what you've done in the past, what you foresee in the future, how you view your life course towards its end, what your purposes are. This is quite different from a mechanical summation over time of a flow of states, state variables. And so it's inherently a life course perspective. There's a need for training to overcome our inbuilt cognitive deficiencies. The great religions have constantly been teaching, you don't think right. That's the main purpose of the sages. You don't think right. You don't know what makes you happy. You're filled with biases. I love Raphael, so here's another Raphael. When Jesus says, why do you look at the speck of sawdust in your brother's eye and pay no attention to the plank in your own eye, he could have said, I'm going to give a lecture on confirmation bias. He had a slightly different point. But Jesus's teachings are filled with the idea about how we get it wrong in the ways we think. Buddhism is all about that, 100%, how to overcome illusions and escape from suffering as a result of the hard work of overcoming illusions. And for Danny Kahneman, I think we learned something that I think is different from what the economics profession has taken from it. Kahneman says here, we think, each of us, that we're much more rational than we are, and we think that we make our good decisions, our decisions, because we have good reasons to make them, even when it's the other way around. We believe in the reasons because we've already made the decision. So, of course, there's a whole body of psychological research on decision-making and what's fast and slow systems, to quote Kahneman's vision of this. And the fast systems are the unconscious determinants of decision-making, and the slow systems are the painful, more prefrontal cortex executive functions, which use a lot of energy, are painful, take time, are a burden. What economists have taken from this in behavioral economics is, well, we make bad decisions, so we should nudge people in the right way. I think it's a horrible idea. I can't stand it, actually. What we should be teaching is that decision-making is hard. We're subject to lots of decision-making that we don't control very clearly, so we should learn to train our mind to understand our cognitive weaknesses, to understand where these gaps come from, to understand that we're primed to decide things quickly that we should be thinking about more slowly, and learn to make better decisions. The idea of nudging, that Cass Sunstein's going to tell me what to do through some secret nudge, I find repellent and a wrong idea of what the real lesson of all of this is. The lesson of all of classical moral teaching is that it's not easy to be good, and so you have to work at it, and you have to work to build virtues, you have to work to build your quality of decision-making, you have to work to make your life meaningful. And that's, I believe, what we should be teaching, and my hypothesis, I have no, unfortunately, no up-to-date data on it, is that this is what thriving is, and this is about what centering emotional stability and giving meaning to life and giving purpose is about. And while I don't want to say that all anxiety disorders or other disorders are some is purely organic functioning, a lot of it is, I believe, centered in the disarray of people's lives that have not been helped in their nurturing or their environment or their early development to find meaning, purpose, understanding, path to flourishing, path to virtue, and so forth. We also know that power and wealth really are literally corrupting. So Lord Acton's great maxim is not just the best slogan in the world, it's actually clinically true. And there are constant flow of data that show that wealth or unearned gains of some sort or another also lead to a corruption of values and to the increased malevolence of actions as well. And so this is a basic point of individuals that are the paradox of those who strike it rich not being very happy necessarily, but I think even more important is making others miserable, which is often goes along with being super wealthy. And we have a president that's going to put that to the test now. So some conclusions on cultivating virtue. I'm quoting myself here. Individual development is a lifelong process in which a healthy environment, parental nurturing, lifelong education, mentorship, habit formation, political decency, and mindfulness and mental health support shape an individual's virtues, including capacities for friendship, trust, and generosity. It can be undermined by material deprivation, excessive power, distrust, and mental disorders, including mental illnesses and disorders promoted by social institutions, including government and the market. Now, let me contrast that briefly with the Anglo-American utility model, which is the core workhorse model of basic economics. And the model that we're taught of human nature has three points to it. One is that you have preferences. Hume called them passions. And they just exist. They dominate. They guide your choice. So you have your preferences. Second, your preferences are given. They're not cultivated. The idea in economics that you build your preferences is nonsensical in mainstream economics. Economists wouldn't even know where to start because they have no idea of the good. So they have no idea of what kind of preferences would you want to build. Generosity, well, that's just your choice. Malevolence, yeah, that's preferences. You take them as given. Gustavus non disputatum est is one of the first things that you learn as an economist. You're not to argue over preferences, and they just exist. And third is the primacy of material conditions over virtue and trust, which in mainstream economics don't even appear, of course, in determinants of well-being. Well, it happens that I think Hume got us started on a very bad path, actually. We speak not strictly and philosophically when we talk of the combat of passion and of reason. Reason is and ought only to be the slave of the passions and can never pretend to any other office than to serve and obey them. So where Aristotle said that reason was man's highest calling and you had to devote yourself to building your capacity for reason, Hume basically said, not worth trying. We are governed by our passions and our reason is essentially slave to passion. And Hume made another disastrous point, in my view, which is his basic separation of is and ought, which to my mind is just a massive intellectual confusion, because where he said you can never derive ought from is. But ought is in a context. What ought means in moral philosophy is what helps human beings to flourish. And that's why Aristotle rightly said that morality can be a science. It's the study of human well-being. That's what's being recreated again. And you can derive ought from is in that sense, because the ought is about us. And we can say a lot of things about us that are meaningful. And so the idea that you can derive a morality that isn't just a matter of flippant taste. And in fact, Hume has the famous example that it's no more rational for me to care about the destruction of the Indian sub, I don't remember exactly how he put it, I think it was India versus the nick to my finger. No, that's insanity. That's not rationality. And so I think the terms got completely confused, but it gave a whole direction to Anglo and then Anglo-American political economy, which basically took the values out of it and said that values are just arbitrary choices. And of course, A.J. Ayer and analytical philosophy in the 20th century further went this direction, and I think we're recovering from it now. Bentham, not my favorite in this way, but Richard's favorite, and Bentham's better than I'm about to say, but not as good as Richard thinks he is. He said, nature has placed mankind under the governance of two sovereign masters, pain and pleasure. It is for them alone to point out what we ought to do, as well as to determine what we shall do. And again, to my mind, this is very different from the cultivation of virtues. This is on the way to Sidgwick, and to eventually to Robbins and Samuelson and our vision of the utility function. So instead of cultivating virtue and trust, the Anglo-American model favors nudging through unseen correction of failures in reasoning and the failures of affective forecasting. And this is just a terrible idea. But nudging is kind of the superficial band-aid to a failed field. If the field doesn't address values straightforwardly, if it doesn't address how to help people center their lives, then you nudge them, and best to nudge them in a hidden way. That's the whole idea of nudging. But that's not the idea to human flourishing, it seems to me. So, second big category that I mentioned was cultivating social trust. This is another place for us to invest in decent society. I make a basic point. Social trust built on norms of honesty, equality, and compassion depend on a dynamic feedback between social norms and individual virtue. And it's easy to realize that this gives rise to multiple equilibria, the good outcome and the bad outcome. You can imagine a society which has shared social norms of honesty, equality, and compassion. And that leads to habits formation and mentorship and guidance of the virtues. And that reinforces the honesty, equality, and compassion in the society. And you can imagine another kind of society, for whatever reason, mainly historical often, where honesty, equality, and compassion have been obliterated for some reason, maybe colonial conquest or war or some other 75 years of communist rule in the Soviet Union or other factors. And so the norms have disappeared. And the virtues have disappeared as well, because if the virtues are based on the habit of behavior and they're not reinforced by social norms, and then an unvirtuous population does not reinforce these norms, one can end up with a kind of lawless society. And we can see, I believe, pretty clearly some places that really work well. And my number one candidates in the world for that are the Scandinavian countries. They're under the threat of globalization like everyone else, but they created what I would say are the good equilibria, where the norms of honesty, equality, and compassion are strong, and those have feedbacks to personal behavior. And then one can see behavior on the other side, and I would say post-communist Russia, but it's also post-serfdom Russia, is another example where the norms of honesty are very, very low, where there's relentless corruption, tax evasion, people have done that to survive also for a long time, because lying was the only way to survive. And you end up with bizarre behavior where very low trust. And interestingly, in some of these experiments of altruistic punishment that you may be aware of, where altruism is sustained by punishers willing to incur resources to punish the non-cooperators, in a few places in the world, and some of the post-communist places are among them, the people who are punished are the cooperators, not the non-cooperators. So you have altruistic punishment of cooperators. In other words, how dare he try to establish a norm of good behavior? That's a threat to me. And so you have actually people intervening to undermine those who would otherwise cooperate. That exists in the world, and it's extraordinarily dangerous, and it's very serious. So trustful societies pay their taxes, they maintain low corruption, they provide quality public services, and they maintain social norms of honesty and contract fulfillment. And these are measurable, and they're all highly intercorrelated. I say trust needs to be cultivated through public investments in norm promotion and norm enforcement backed by equitable and compassionate public policies. There are, however, three crucial dangers with norm enforcement. The first one that's obvious is authoritarianism. We even bristle at the idea that government should make us good. But to give that up is horrible. Of course, to take it at face value is dangerous, because we do fear government enforcing the good in some not so good way. And so we have to balance the benefits of creating social norms with the dangers of creating an authoritarian society. We also know that another problem is untrammeled greed in oligarchic societies. The United States is absolutely moving in this direction. We have put Ayn Rand, which is a particularly American pathology, into actual operation as a social philosophy. It's unbelievable. It's a social disease, and we have it in large amount now, which is that the idea of getting your way is the way, and that that's what has been instilled. And I can tell you literally, when I write a kind of social critique op-ed, I wrote something about one of our drug companies that has priced its life-saving drug at 1,000 times its marginal cost, leading hundreds of thousands of people to death. It's the hepatitis C drug of Gilead Sciences. I get feedback, hostile feedback, and invariably, by the way, it comes from Wall Street. And it's meant not trolling, it's meant straightforwardly. Professor Sachs, what's the matter with that? Why are you complaining that people are dying? That's how the market system works. This is adults, not in jail. They deserve to be in jail, many of them. But this is actually adult reasoning. And it's meant seriously. It's not meant as an attack. It's meant as a question. So that's the second risk. And the third risk, of course, is that when you enforce social norms, one of the points that is very clear is that you can enforce norms of patriotism and others for the purposes of attack on others. So we constantly have the challenge of creating social norms without creating an in-group, out-group dynamic. And of course, just observe the Milgram experiments of authoritarianism and how easy it is to shirk responsibility within a social norm setting. And my guru, E.O. Wilson, who has been writing about how individual selection tends to promote opportunistic prisoner's dilemma, defect behavior, whereas actually group intergroup conflict promotes the virtues of group norms. The idea being that we evolved at two levels of as a species, competition within groups, which lead actually to selfishness, and competition between groups, which lead to within group norms. But our within group norms are almost inherently us versus them identity norms. So we're good at trust when it's our trust versus the foe. And this is, of course, extraordinarily dangerous. So a few tentative conclusions on the cultivation of trust. Trust is cultivated through the propagation and enforcement of social norms. Trust is vulnerable to self-fulfilling collapse and to vast inequalities of wealth and power. Trust can become perverted into authoritarianism, and intragroup trust can give rise to intergroup conflict, hence the case for global norms rather than narrow group norms. I like norms like the Sustainable Development Goals in part because they're universal norms, and I like the fact that norms like the Golden Rule are norms of all great religions, and great scholars have analyzed the fundamental norms of our leading religions and argued persuasively in my mind that they share fundamental objectives, even though often within those religions there's a great body of us versus them, reasoning, so the norms are applying to the within group co-religionists, but the types of norms are actually global. Let me say a word about corporations and social trust, because corporations play such a profound role in our sociology. Corporations are powerful, hierarchical, and essentially amoral organizations devoted to increasing the wealth of owners and managers. They are ticking time bombs in society the way they're organized, because they're extremely powerful, but they are by design organized without norms. The only norm is the profit-seeking or value-maximizing norm. Corporations can become authoritarian. Trust within corporations can devolve into complicity and illegality and immorality. And corporate norms can easily be twisted into a culture of corruption. There's a marvelous recent study in Nature magazine about the corporate culture of an international, major international bank. And the research design exposes how simply priming the subjects to think of themselves as bankers leads to immoral behavior, essentially lying on a simple test that they're given. And the conclusion, which I find compelling living a couple miles from Wall Street, is that it's a gang of thieves, which it is. And it's a gang of thieves that has a friends who are gangs of thieves in the White House and the Treasury, so we're really stuck right now. And no one will say boo about it. One of the great heroes of American Wall Street is John Paulson, who committed fraud to defraud German investors out of $1 billion. And he is lauded on Wall Street for this. The SEC never went after him for anything. And he gave $400 million of it to Harvard Engineering School, which I suggested that they rename after the IKB Bank of Germany. Because it wasn't Paulson's money, he stole it from the Germans, but Harvard didn't agree with that idea. I think that it's part of our prevailing culture. So given the dangers from corporations, I argue the company law should specify explicitly multi-stakeholder representation in its governance, true value creation that by law repudiates the imposition of externalities as a source of corporate value-seeking, profit-making, and legal responsibility and accountability of the corporate board and managers on a personal level. So let me just conclude what I believe we are moving towards through the body of research that is in the new book being released here, in the great work that my colleagues have done on happiness, in the neuroscience, and the synthesis, I would say, with the great sages, because what they told us stands up to 2,300-plus years of evidence. I'll summarize it this way. Eudaimonia depends on the cultivation of individual virtues, social trust, and material prosperity. Individual virtues are cultivated, not inherited, and depend on a nurturing environment, early childhood development, education, mentoring, and habit formation. Social trust depends on the cultivation and defense of group norms. Global values are of paramount importance. Virtue can be squandered through the lack of education, training, cognitive limitations, and mental disorders. Building virtue is a lifelong process. Redemption is possible through training, mental health, and counseling. Trust is vulnerable to a self-fulfilling collapse of norms and a subsequent collapse of virtues. Trust can devolve into authoritarianism, untrammeled greed, and intergroup conflict. Corporations are powerful intermediary structures, highly vulnerable to authoritarianism and a culture of illegality and immorality. Company law and corporate law enforcement are both critical to prevent an environment of cultural impunity. Governments have a major role to play in promoting eudaimonia. Yet governments are profoundly vulnerable to corruption, oligarchy, authoritarianism, and the fostering of between-group violence. And finally, I say the emerging synthesis is highly consistent with John Helliwell's Big Six determinants of subjective well-being: income, health, freedom to make life choices, social support, generosity and compassion, and trust in government. Thank you very much.
I think that's a tremendous sort of truth. I'm sure there are people dying to make remarks, but I think we'll have to do that over lunch. But I'm allowed to make two.
Good. Okay.
Just first, I want to say that I think that what Jeff said is completely consistent with the idea of maximizing the well-being of the members of society if you take the role of behavior into account in the way which I was trying to introduce it, where I think it's hitherto been missing. And I think that I agree with Bentham about the first proposition, I don't agree with him about how you acquire good behavior. You acquire it not just because it's satisfying, though the Dalai Lama points out that if it's a byproduct, it can be sometimes, but you acquire it by habit. This is absolutely fundamental that the whole ethos of society needs to change. So the real issue, I mean, here, are we preaching in the wilderness? Or will we see a change of culture? And the thing which gives me heart is that we had a complete change of culture 200 years ago in this country. Up to 1790, it was almost impossible for a person in public life to make a moral statement. There were shouts, literally, cant. The word cant was what people got shouted down if they said anything serious, like Jeff has been saying. And somebody tried to found a society for the promotion of virtue, no members. By the 1830s, completely different culture. Abolition of slavery, development of universal suffrage, original elements in the welfare state, a deeply serious society, much more like the one that Jeff would have than the one 40 years earlier. So I think we are talking about not just re-regulation of sectors and that sort of thing. We are talking about a fundamental change of culture. And I think that the well-being movement is probably the single leading element in promoting that change of culture. Anyway, let's stop now. Now, lunch is up back where we had the coffee, and we will start again on time at 2:30.